Big thanks to organizers for putting up this wonderful conference. I'm really grateful for basically everything. In this presentation, I'm going to talk about the paper about the assumption of rank invariance or rank similarity in quantile regression models under the program evaluation framework. Okay, so this is joint work with Xin Dong in UC Irvine. Now, in program evaluations, applied researchers do care about treatment effect heterogeneity and often look at distributional or quantile effects of treatments. And typically, there are enough data to support these pursuits, so that's good. Now, if we look at the quantile treatment effect models, we often see an assumption of rank invariance or rank similarity floating around, either for identification purpose or for interpretation of the estimation results. For example, in the IDQR models of Chunochukov-Hansen, this is imposed to put restrictions on the involvement of individuals' rank across treatment states, and so that the quantile treatment effect can be identified for the whole distribution, even though the treatment is endogenous. Now, in another line of the work, the quantile treatment effect is identified only for the compliers, and that's why it's called local. And in that literature, rank invariance or rank similarity is not required for identification, but when they are these estimation methods are applied to data sets, typically people wish that they have rank invariance or similarity so that the QTE estimates can be interpreted as individual causal effects. Okay, so I have been saying this word term of rank invariance or similarity more generally, but actually this assumption means different things in different models. Now, in conditional quantile regression models, this restriction is imposed on the conditional rank of the outcome variables, like the IVQR models. But then in unconditional quantile models, when people talk about rank preservation in interpreting results, they typically mean that to put the restriction on the unconditional rank of the outcome variables. Okay. Now, in this paper, we mainly study the assumption of unconditional rank invariance or rank similarity because it's an important concept in program evaluation framework because people care about the welfare of those unconditionally poor or the test score of unconditionally lower ranked students. We provide identification and then nonparametric testing methods that are applicable to both exogenous and the endogenous treatment cases. Okay, so in this presentation, I'm going to walk you through two applications. One is a STAR project application, and another is the JTPA training program. Now, the STAR project, we didn't include that in the paper. In the paper, we did the JTPA training program. It's because just as maybe the concern McKelly point out about these peer effects that actually are not considered in the STAR project literature and not considered in our framework. But just for illustration purpose, I pull out this example because it has a nice feature of it has exogenous treatment. And I'll also show you an example where when we focus on the rank, actually, we get some new insights where the previous literature that didn't talk about or didn't find, okay? And to be specific, for people not familiar with the STAR project, it studies the effect of attending a small class in kindergarten on students' outcome. And we focus on the test score because that's the only data available. But other people have studied income as well, okay. So the punchline of this whole literature is trying to say that the small class treatment seems to be helpful for everyone. And on the other hand, if you look at these dotted lines, there are actually two dotted lines here. One is a regular class, one is actually another treatment. It's giving an extra aid teacher to a regular class. And the literature typically, literature concludes that giving an aid does not seem to affect to make a difference. And when ATEs or QTEs are estimated, these two, the control or and this type of treatment, they are grouped together as a control group, okay? So we will see that when we focus on rank, there are some different discoveries. And these vertical arrows are used to show you the idea of the rank preservation assumption. So so that these horizontal differences, which are the QTEs, can be thought of as individual treatment effects. Okay. Now, the JDPA training program studies the effect of job training on individual earnings, because not everyone assigned to treatment actually receive training. So it's an endogenous treatment framework with a valid instrument. And the punchline of this literature is that it seems that there's effect in this training program, and effect is a lot larger for female. Okay, but when we look at the testing, actually the result is a bit different as well, as I will talk more about these. Okay, now let's formally put up the definition of rank invariance and rank similarity. So I use U0 and U1 to denote unconditional ranks of potential outcomes. And rank invariance is the assumption that they are the same variables. Okay. So, and directly implies individual treatment effect from QTE. Okay. Now, this assumption is very restrictive, actually. My favorite example is try to think myself taking the GRE test 10 years ago. And I believe that if I were given the exam same test in a different room or maybe even in a different day, I would get a different score because I know how many times I flipped the coin, right? So there must be a luck component that determines the test score besides people's observed characteristics and besides people's ability. Okay, so in that case, if we put that in, rank invariance is generalized to rank similarity, where we assume that for individuals defined on observables and individuals defined on unobservables, the unconditional ranks of potential outcomes have the same distribution. Okay, now with this generalization, we instantly lose the point identification of these individual causal effects because now we have a full distribution. But we can also get something nice from this assumption that helps us to understand QTE as more or less of a causal argument, in the sense that although we lose point identification of individual treatment effects, when we integrate these QTEs, when we take the weighted average of the QTEs weighted by individual's probability of being at different quantiles, then actually we get the average treatment effect of a specific individual defined on X and defined on V. Okay? And with that assumption, actually we also have this property, which actually we see a lot in applied papers, is that rank similarity implies that the distribution of observables and unobservable at the same rank are the same across treatment states. Okay. And then, of course, when the potential ranks have the same distribution, conditional on observables and unobservables, then treatment does not affect the distribution of ranks among observationally equivalent individuals. And that will be our main testable implication for rank similarity. And this is a necessary condition, and we do not tell the unobserved, the V part of the rank similarity condition. Okay. So to put up a test based on this equality, first we need to do identification of this conditional distribution of the unconditional ranks. Okay. So in the exogenous treatment, this identification is like trivial. And you can imagine from this this line that estimation is also straightforward using a two-step procedure, where in the first step we estimate this quantile functions, and in the second step we turn these expectations to its sample analogs, the sample means. Okay. Now, when the treatment is endogenous, the rank similarity, testing for rank similarity is a little bit more subtle, in the sense that we follow the LQTE framework, and then the things are only identified among compliers, the potential ranks, the potential outcome distributions. Okay, so essentially what we are testing is the distribution of potential ranks. Actually, I forgot to put it here. This U1 and U0 now defined actually a shorthand notation of U1 and U0 conditional on C. So these are the potential ranks, the unconditional ranks of potential outcomes among compliers. And we want to study whether this conditional distribution of these unconditional ranks are the same. Among individuals defined on XC, where XC is the part of the X support where there is non-trivial existence of compliers. Okay. And to be able to identify, we need an instrument. And this is the classic identifying assumptions for the late framework. Okay, so here is the identification result. So with these assumptions, we will be able to identify the conditional distribution of the unconditional ranks as the ratio of two intent to treat concepts. The denominator is the proportion complier, and the numerator is the reduced form conditional distribution of a rank indicator conditional on different values of this instrument Z. Okay. Now, this function is defined only on XC, as I talked about earlier. But if we want to test for the equality of these two conditional distributions of unconditional ranks, we only need to use the numerator, and there we can extend the support from XC to X, because this equality holds trivially for the always takers and the never takers. Okay. And if you want to post estimation, you want to get some idea of the sign and the magnitude of the change in the ranks, and then the estimation is based on equation one. Okay. Now this theorem gives result for the whole distribution of the conditional distribution of the unconditional ranks. It obviously implies that the identification of specific features of the distribution, such as the mean. So there's no surprise. We just need to integrate over tau. Okay, and here come some graphs. So here is the star project. In the top two graphs, I compare the conditional distribution of the unconditional ranks. Okay, and the top two graphs is small class treatment versus regular class treatment. And this graph is just by race. just conditioned on one variable, race, and this is white, this is non-white. And the solid lines are the treatment under treatment, and the dotted lines are under control, okay? And then these are the rank changes, and if we split the data by boys and girls, okay? So we do see that the small class, at least in, I don't put up an inference here yet, but it does suggest that it helps the ranking of the disadvantaged students, like the non-white and the boys, okay? Okay, there are stochastic dominance here, okay? And then, but if you look at the bottom two graphs, the graphs where we compare the regular class with aid versus regular classes, where the literature actually find there is no kind of effect of these treatments giving extra aid to the class, we see kind of a more shuffling of the rank among boys and girls with this specific treatment, okay? So something's going on there. Now, for the JTPA training program, I did the same sort of graphs just for illustration purpose. Each graph, we divide data by one dummy variable and plot out the conditional distribution of the unconditional ranks in treatment status and in control status. And we found that, remember previously for female, we see a larger shift in the QTEs, but then apparently there are more rank shuffling among males, okay? So the next, so I haven't talked anything about inference yet. The next question is obviously, okay, are these significant or not? Okay. First of all, right now these figures are only like each of them, they split the data by one one X variables. We want to do a multiple dimension, and also we want to account for the different quantiles together and do a joint test. Okay, so here's a joint test, the benchmark joint test that we do, where the conditional X variable is restricted to, is assumed to be on a finite support. So you can think about it as, like in our empirical example, we have like 10 or, I don't know, 15 dummy variables. And in that sense, we are on a finite discrete support, okay? Now, in the extension section of this paper, we look at the case where this X includes condition, X includes continuous variables. But it happens to be not the case in our empirical example, okay? So then we consider also a finite number of quantiles, K number of quantiles. Now, originally, we started from thinking about doing it uniformly over tau from 0 and 1. But then the issue is, for exogenous case, it's okay. For endogenous case, we need a first stage estimator of these unconditional quantile functions among compliers. And the previous theory is developed on pointwise inference. So either what we can do is we assume uniform convergence at the first stage, or we leave this problem to smarter people to work on in the future. So right now, and for the benchmark test, finite X values and finite K values. Okay, we will be able to relax this, but not this. We want to test whether this M0 function and this M1 function, two conditional means, are the same for a bunch of different values of J and K. It's a joint test. And the M functions are estimated in two steps. First step are the unconditional quantile functions proposed in the previous literature by Floch and Malley. And this has a state-hard program to do it, which is great. And then second stage, you plug this in and do sample counterpart of the conditional expectations. And then you can construct a word type test very easily. Now the remaining issue is how to estimate this V hat, the variance covariance matrix of these M1 minus M0 vectors, which actually compiles all the different M functions here. Okay. So here are the assumptions we need for the asymptotic properties. The first three are for the first step. The last one is for to be able to pass through the asymptotic from the first step to the second step. Okay. Now, this is the result. When we have k times j minus 1 number of moments, and we have a big variance covariance matrix. Okay, so these M functions the estimators of these M functions, they are correlated not only across these different tau values but also across the different x values. Even though we have ID data, that is because of the first stage estimation error, which the first stage estimation uses all of the data, and then the second and third part of this phi function actually captures this estimation error in the first stage of this Q hat unconditional quantile functions. Okay. So if they were known, then the phi will be greatly reduced to a simplified version, and this variance covariance matrix can be a lot easier. Now, we can think about if the dimension of the conditional set of this x is pretty large, then probably we were going to have a faster convergence rate in the first step and a slower convergence rate in the second step, right? So then the first stage estimation error might be ignored, and we can simplify the asymptotic variance covariance matrix, and we are going to discuss this extension where j go to infinity later. But right now, with this formula, we think it's not inevitable to do a bootstrap of this V hat estimator. Okay. Now, again, I want to mention that this test is consistent for the null hypothesis that the treatment does not affect the rank, unconditional rank, among observationally equivalent individuals. It does not test the unobservable part of rank, the rank invariance or rank similarity assumption. Okay, we can also do a mean test. And let me maybe skip it. It's not much different from the distributional test, but now we need to kind of take an average over different taus. And then the asymptotic is also, we have a kind of integration average over different tau values. Okay. Now, let's look at some simulation evidence. So this is the main DGP that I consider. And I change the value of this B, where this B controls the size of violation of this rank invariance or rank similarity assumption. If B equals to 0, it holds. B gets larger, the assumption is violated in larger order. In the endogenous treatment case, the endogenous treatment decision is modeled by a Roy type model. So these are the true DGPs. B equal to 0, where basically you cannot see any of the rank shifts. So the rank similarity holds, and the conditional distribution of the unconditional ranks are the same across treatment states. And then we increase B, and we see more and more of these violations in rank similarity. Okay. Now, here are the simulation results for the exogenous case and for the endogenous case. Let's look at the graph, it's easier. So this graph, we increase the violation, the magnitude of the violation, and we see power going to 1 for 3 lines, I'll explain. And this graph, we increase the sample size, and we see increase of power for 3 tests. And they are the middle 3 tests where we use a number of different tau values. And we think that's intuitive because rank invariance and rank similarity, they are a distributional concepts, right? So if we do a mean testing or a median testing, obviously we are going to lose some power in some cases. Okay, and then the endogenous case, we see a similar pattern of power performance, and size are well controlled. Okay, now let's get back to the empirical results, and then I'll talk about the extensions of the tests. Now, for the star example, remember earlier I talked about this treatment of assigning a small class to a student and the treatment of assigning additional teaching aid to a regular class. Okay, so the literature tends to believe that this additional aid doesn't matter, but actually it shuffles students' rank a lot. Okay, even more than that for the small class treatment. Okay, and if we also did a falsification test where we used the student's birthday as the outcome variable, which we wouldn't believe any of the treatment would affect this outcome, right? So then the p-values, we fail to reject this null hypothesis. Okay. So the conclusions from the STAR project, the analysis is that for both treatment, actually, they improve the rank distribution of the disadvantaged students. And then it questions a bit of the practice of using both the regular class with aid and without aid as a control group in the analysis. There are more complicated matter in this business, okay? Now, for the JTPA training programming example, we use the exact same data of Abadi, Engress, and Inbens and exact same X variables. So here is kind of the repetition of the female and the male graph that I put up. And here we see that, and these are point-wise standard errors. We see that in terms of unconditional quantile treatment effects, we see a lot larger and more significant effects for females. Okay? But then in terms of testing, we are able to reject rank rank similarity for both female and for male. And the test statistic is actually a lot larger for female than for male. Okay, and then if we do a falsification test, again use a irrelevant outcome variable which is age, we are unable to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, now let's take a closer look at these tests at different quantiles, and compare the female sample and the male sample and the results. We find that previously, if we look at unconditional QTEs, we see all the stars here and large effects. But then the rank shuffling of among female subpopulation is restricted kind of to only to the lower quantiles, the lower part of the distribution. And then for the males, the rank shuffling is throughout the distribution. So again, we are kind of seeing different things, and when we look at the unconditional QTE itself, and we look at the kind of the unconditional ranks and how they suffer when conditional on the x variables, okay? So, we also did the mean test I talked about earlier, about rank similarity. So, and in that case, again, we see the evidence is of rank shuffling is stronger for male, and for female, in that case, it's only marginally significant. Okay. So the conclusion here for the JTPA analysis is, again, training causes individuals to systematically change their ranks in the earnings distribution. And there are things going on that's more complicated than what the unconditional QTE tells us, okay? And of course, we shall be cautious when we put equality between the QTEs and individual treatment effects. And this result is also largely agree with Heckman, Smith, and Clement paper, where they also find that rank preservation is not credible in treatment, in training program framework. Okay. Now, these are the benchmark models and my empirical analysis. Now, let me briefly talk about three extensions. Okay, as I promised earlier. The first extension, remember earlier, we have this conditional set of x where the number of x variable is fixed. Now we want to allow a j to go to infinity, okay? Now if we allow j to go to infinity, what happens is this asymptotic no longer works because this pzx, the probability goes to zero in the limit, right? So we need something new, something else. And we also hope that in this case, we will be able to get, when researchers have a lot of data and a lot of x variables, they can get rid of this bootstrap component because it's really computational expensive with a lot of data, okay? So, these are assumptions we want to make, we need to make. And the test is constructed as following. For each of these x values, we need enough individuals on each of these subsamples. And then we were going to have a convergence result of these conditional distributions of unconditional quantiles for each of the j's. And we get this zj. Limiting distributions, and they will have very nice variance-covariance matrix. Remember earlier, I have a variance-covariance matrix has three terms, and the last two terms are very difficult to estimate, and they are caused by first-stage estimation. And now, because the convergence rate of the first stage is square root n, and the second stage is slower, we get rid of that two annoying parts, okay? Now, that which means that we will be easily able to estimate this variance-covariance matrix using an analytical formula, okay? And then how to deal with an increasing number of j? For each j, we define a word type test statistic, and that converges to chi-square under the null. And then when we pull everything together, we use the property of this chi-square, that is, you subtract the degree of freedom and divide by square root 2 times the degree of freedom, you get a normal. Okay. And we can actually also have a simulation result that shows that this works pretty well. And then for continuous covariate case, we can apply the true of Lee and Rosen framework. If there is a continuous variable in the conditioning set, and to construct a Kolmogorov-Smirnov type test statistic, and then construct a critical value C alpha based on multiplier bootstrap. Okay. Now, again, in this case, the first stage doesn't matter because this is square root n, this is lower. Okay. It's kernel type estimation. The third extension, I've been talking about unconditional ranks, but actually our test can be modified to conditional ranks in a restrictive sense, in that we can estimate the conditional quantiles conditioning on some covariates like female male, okay, but then use that to some additional covariates x2 to perform the test. So to be very explicit, so in that sense, we need extra x2s for the testing, so our test is not a test for the conditional rank invariance or rank similarity assumption imposed, say, in the IVQR framework. So now I wrap up. In this paper, we consider a rank analysis and look at the assumption of rank invariance and rank similarity, unconditional rank invariance and rank similarity in quantile regressions in programming evaluation frameworks. And our test explores whether the treatment changes the rank distribution among observationally equivalent individuals. Tests have good size power, and when we applied it to data sets, we find that rank analysis oftentimes give different insights than unconditional QTE estimates would tell. And and here is an incomplete list of the reference. And I want to mention that this project is fairly new and finished like in the spring, and then in the summer we find that other people are also working on similar topics. So, which is great in the sense that people are real. It's not only us are interested in this topic, but it also freaks us out a couple of times. But then, luckily, we don't think we overlap in any of these methods. Okay, and that's it. If I miss some reference, please let me know. Okay, thank you.
So thank you very much. I'm happy to be discussing this paper, which I found to be a very interesting paper. I'm going to talk about the paper from a very applied perspective and actually in a very simple context. So the paper does much more than I'm describing, but I'm going to think about very, very simple context to think about the issues involved. So let me first of all just give some background of a very simple problem that's related. Suppose, this is kind of a classical problem, suppose you have a perfect randomized experiment. So half the people are told to get the treatment, half aren't. For those who get the treatment at random, you observe their Y1, the with treatment outcome. Among those who don't get the treatment, you observe why not, the without treatment outcome. What do you immediately identify? You identify the marginal distribution of treatments, outcomes with treatment, the marginal distribution of outcomes without treatment. You identify nothing directly about the dependence between the two. You don't know anything about correlation or any dependence between Y1 and Y0, and you get partial identification of the joint distribution. You identify the joint distribution as any distribution that has the right marginal distributions. Okay. So the immediate implication of that is you don't identify the distribution of treatment effects, except in degenerate cases. So I can identify quantiles of Y1, I can identify quantiles of Y0, I can take difference of the quantiles. I don't get quantiles of the difference. I don't get quantiles of the treatment effect without more restrictions. I don't get a treatment effect for any individual without more assumptions. So without more assumptions, I can't get very far. I mean, I can get mean effects and so forth, but I can't get anything about the distribution without more assumptions. And a very common additional assumption, as is studied in this paper, is rank invariance. And so rank invariance, as was discussed, is, okay, if I'm the top person in the Y1 distribution, I'm the top person in the Y0 distribution. And as soon as you assume that, you cover the distribution of treatment effects, and life is good. Okay, so just to give a silly, simple example of this, suppose Y1 and Y0 have the same common continuous distribution, and that example, the treatment effect, the quantile treatment effect would be zero for all quantiles. They have the exact same quantiles. It could be the case that Y1 equals Y0, in which case the quantile treatment effect equals the treatment effect for each individual. It could be that Y1 equals minus Y0, for example, if Y1 and Y0 are symmetric around zero. It's possible that Y1 is much bigger than Y0 for some, and Y1 is much smaller for Y0 for others, and there's no one for whom the difference is zero, even though the quantile treatment effect is zero. So the quantile treatment effect could possibly not be very informative about the distribution of treatment effects or about individual level treatment effects. Okay. So, and again, a common restriction, a sensible restriction to start imposing is thinking about rank invariance. Again, if I'm the highest person with Y1, I'm the highest person with Y0, and vice versa. So very often in this kind of context, you have covariates. And covariates allow you to a lot richer level of knowledge. So instead of saying, you know, I observe my Y0, I have no idea what my Y1 would be like. Well, I observe my Y0, and then I'm a guy. And so you look at the Y1s who are also guys, and you know, maybe you don't think if I'm the highest Y0 that the Y1 of the highest female is what Y1 I would have gotten if there's no treated individuals who are guys who got that value of Y1. So immediately using information on covariates, you get more information, you can use that information. A common kind of empirical strategy to document the treatment effects are heterogeneous, the treatment effects vary across individuals, is if the treatment effect on average for men is big and average treatment effect for women is small, well then average treatment effect obviously varies across individuals as you can verify using the covariates. So in practice, rank invariance seems a lot more plausible conditional on X, and you might impose it conditional on X. Among men, you look at the untreated individuals who are white guys in their 40s, you look at the treated individuals who are white guys in their 40s, and you compare those two distributions, not the unconditional distributions. Okay. So this paper tests for unconditional rank invariance or unconditional rank similarity. So unconditional rank similarity is a generalization of unconditional rank invariance. It's an important generalization when thinking about the Chernozuk-Off and Hansen model or other models that followed thereafter for non-separable models. I don't see the importance of testing for unconditional rank similarity because the only place I know rank similarity comes up, as far as I know, is in conditional rank similarity for those kinds of models. They require conditional rank similarity. So I'm not sure of the importance of testing for unconditional rank similarity. I don't know any model that requires that per se. Unconditional rank invariance, I can understand the motivation for it. With unconditional rank invariance, you know, the highest person in the Y1 distribution is the highest person in the Y0 distribution. I recover a distribution of treatment effects. I can interpret quantile treatment effects as individual level treatment effects, and life is good. But it seems much less plausible. So to me, the unconditional rank invariance seems like an extremely strong condition and seems much less plausible than conditional rank invariance. And therefore, I'm not fully convinced of the importance of testing for unconditional rank invariance. Okay, so let me talk a little bit more about this unconditional rank invariance, and I'll talk under the testable restriction examined in this paper in the context of some very, very simple models, because I like simple models. Okay. So let me start off by considering the simplest model I can think of. Suppose we have a linear regression kind of a framework for Y0 and for Y1. So the without treatment outcome is some constant plus some constant coefficient in X plus in the other term, same thing for Y1. So the Y1 minus Y0 treatment effect, alpha1 minus alpha0 is some constant shift. Beta1 minus beta0 is the treatment effect vary with X. I'm going to have X here be binary. And epsilon1 minus epsilon0 is some conditional on X treatment effect heterogeneity. And I'm going to ignore, so the paper does much more complicated things and considers endogenous X. I'm going to take endogenous X, endogenous T. I'm going to take everything exogenous. So, perfect randomized experiment, exogenous X, and so forth. This is like the simplest possible model I can think of. So I can start thinking of this very simple model. When will rank, unconditional rank invariance hold? So in this model, if epsilon 1 equals epsilon naught, conditional rank invariance holds. And given my assumptions, ranks, conditional rank similarity holds anyway. So this is a model where conditionally everything is good. Okay. Let me suppose epsilon 1 equals epsilon naught. Then you can kind of trivially show that conditional rank invariance holds. Conditional rank invariance obviously holds. The distribution of y1 minus 1s identified. Life is good. But if you go to unconditional rank invariance holds if and only if beta 1 equals beta naught. So just kind of intuitively, it makes sense. If the treatment effect is bigger for men than for women, and the distribution of the R term doesn't change, then there's going to be some men who have a bigger effect. They're going to move up in the distribution relative to women, and unconditional rank invariance holds. So whenever you have treatment effect that varies by covariates, you'd expect unconditional rank invariance to fail, even though conditional rank invariance may well hold. Now let me consider the case where epsilon 1 is like a rescaled version of epsilon naught. So this is, you know, treatment effect is, you know, expanding the distribution of epsilon naught or shrinking the distribution of epsilon naught. So in that case, rank invariance holds if and only if the effect of X on the treatment effect exactly offsets it. So you have this knife edge result that if the distribution of epsilon expands, you're going to still have unconditional rank invariance if and only if the effect of X on the treatment effect expands and is exactly the right way. And if you consider more general models for epsilon 1 and epsilon naught, you get this knife edge result that as I, you know, if epsilon 1 equals epsilon naught, I get a knife edge, beta 1 has to equal beta naught. If epsilon 1 is an expanded or shrunken version of epsilon naught, if and only if beta 1 has this exact equality here. If I do other more generalizations, it's really hard to satisfy. So to me, rank invariance seems very hard. Unconditional rank invariance seems extremely hard to satisfy. And it would be hard for me to think of examples where I think it would hold. If the treatment effect varies by X, it gets violated. It doesn't vary with X, but the distribution of unobservables or shocks changes, it's going to be violated. So just to wrap up, the testable restriction here, which is a testable restriction for unconditional rank invariance, seems extremely strong to me. I have trouble thinking of models that will satisfy it. You get these knife edge results where, you know, things have to exactly balance to make it satisfied. It kind of reminds me a little bit of a common argument for an implied work where people will say, do mean effects seem to vary by observables? If the mean effects seem to vary by observables, well, then I know the unconditional distribution of y1 minus y0 is not degenerate. I mean, some people have different effects because they're different for men than for women. Okay, and this seems kind of similar and kind of complementary, though it's studying a different question. And also, I started thinking maybe it'd be interesting to look at a stochastic dominance version of the condition rather than a equality version. So again, the stochastic invariance, I'm sorry, rank invariance just seems too strong to me. I mean, it seems like something that's going to be violated in any reasonable model. Maybe it'd be interesting for policy purposes to look at a stochastic dominance version of it. So for example, if we're worried about male wages versus female wages, and we think there's a problem that not enough women are at the high ranks of the earnings distribution, and we have a treatment effect we might care about, well, is the distribution of women's ranks moving up with the treatment? Or if we're worried about, you know, other minorities or disadvantaged groups, we might think to ourselves, okay, we care about whether the treatment is improving the ranks of those groups in terms of inequality. So just, I think my time's up, and actually I'm done. So my conclusion here, from my perspective, the testing for rank similarity seemed like a red herring because I know why I care about conditional rank similarity for models like Chernozukov and Hansen. I don't know why I care about unconditional rank similarity. For rank invariance, I understand why I could care about conditional or unconditional rank invariance. It allows me to capture the distribution of treatment effects. But unconditional rank invariance just seems way too strong to me and therefore implausible. Okay, thank you.